Sam Altman and Nvidia are saying nobody's going to write code by July, and while vibe coders are creating some beautiful, beautiful LinkedIn posts, some figured out the hard way that their vibes are getting crushed by raging devs making a point out of showing them that software engineering isn't dead just because you can create a landing page in 2 hours. I'm not dunking on AI here. Quite the contrary, I use it every day for real, hard engineering tasks, and it made my prototyping and yes, creating dashboards and beautiful landing pages in no time a reality for backend dudes like myself. But still, if you believe the reports, companies seem to dial down their new hiring and the horizon doesn't seem bright for future developers. I, for one, think that AI is going to take over coding work, but only to prove, again, that Newton's third law is accurate, and alongside great projects, there is a pile of mess that's already been created by LLMs and it's going to take a lot of seniors paid big bucks to take control over. So, is all of the engineering work going to be obsolete? No, at least I don't think so. To be honest, I think it's the other way around.
The creative side of coding, I think, doesn't go away. I think, if anything, programmers get even more leveraged and more powerful, and rather than computing replacing programmers, programmers use AI to replace everybody else.
Those who will deepen their knowledge in these three areas are probably going to not only survive the AI flood, but rather become the hottest commodity in the market of puzzled vibe coders. Well, the hottest commodity, second only to Nvidia employees who are actually willing to do some work. When posts about vibe coders losing work and others getting hacked showed up a few weeks ago, The Prime and others tweeted learn to code and then learn to debug, others literally started explaining cores and the importance of secrets management. Which leads us to point number one. Learn to hack. No, not to hack vibe coders because they're annoying. I mean, yeah, they are, but like it or not, we're soon handing over much of the tedious work of coding to our unhuman friends. But there's a huge problem with that. They're trained on our code, and a lot of it is insecure, to say the least. Let me show you. I want to show just how common it is to hack real production systems. Let's start with the base. If we want to learn smart, the best approach is to tackle the most common issues, right? The Open Worldwide Application Security Project, or AppSec project, or just OASP, is my go-to to find common vulnerabilities. Its top 10 list is very famous and used as a reference by many bug hunters. While the current data is dated back to 2021, very soon we're going to see 2025 updated metrics. But for the time being, let's just focus on what's based on this data is the most prevalent security hole in most systems, broken access control. It made quite a jump from 2017 from 5th place, and if you ask me, we're going to have a ton of AI generated code, so it's going to stay up on top for sure. Remember the dude who tweeted about getting hacked and started getting first aid from kind responders telling him about cores? Well, the same cores is one of the misconfigurations under broken access. Just under that, there's the magnificent unauthenticated access for unprivileged users. Let's use Lovable, my personal vibe coding favorite and this video's sponsor, to actually create the vulnerability. Pretty sure that's the first time anyone asks from Lovable that, but nevertheless, it does an amazing job. Here's my new SaaS, Secure Profile. Great name for a very bad idea. I'll log in with the credentials that are kindly printed out on the screen, and now let's start on easy mode. My regular user profile is shown. Checking the URL shows an interesting variable, my user ID after profile. Change the ID to see what's up, and what do you know, there's Alice Johnson's profile. Not cool. But you're probably thinking, nobody uses that easy to exploit apps. To that I respond, mostly, you're right, but wait just 1 minute to see real world current issue of that magnitude. But before that, let's make things a tiny bit harder and ask Lovable to increase the difficulty. So when I'm logged out, profiles aren't accessible, which goes to show that the auth token here serves like a VPN. Only if you have a password, you can come in, but once you're in, you can go wherever you like. Logging back in, and then the profile is loaded. The user ID isn't as simple now, but wait, I can't read that, but it does seem a little bit familiar, doesn't it? I'm thinking Base64, which is not an encryption algorithm, but only an encoding algorithm, which means it can be decoded directly. So, Base64 decode and voila, user 2 profile. I wonder what happens if the 2 is replaced with 3 and then encoded back, and boom, we're in. Want the admin user, encode it with 1, and there we have it. But these are engineered bugs we created by abusing Lovable. Let's check out the real system. Disclaimer, just doing what I'm doing here is not legal without either consent or full report of findings to the platform, which I've done, so keep that in mind. I will hide their name, not to shame anyone, but it's a large wellness centers all around Europe, lots of you probably know. So the first thing people actually shouldn't be able to see are other users' data, right? Well, let's use the first and probably best friend of any hacker, a good proxy. Most bug hunters and researchers are using Burp Suite, so we'll use that one and an iPhone on the side that sends its request through Burp's proxy. Let's start easy by getting a tennis court for today. Searching for a name comes up with some results. This already feels weird. Let's see what the data actually looks like before it hits my phone. I'll catch the response and yeah, there's a bunch of things here not showing up on the app and probably shouldn't be sent back from the database. You can also tell whether a user is suspended, you can assume his subscription tier based on whether they have to pay for booking, etc. If I search for a test user, there's a lot of them. Someone is in testing and staging here. If we send the request without the search attribute, there's an error. But sending it with the attribute key and no value returns all the results from the database, starting at the very first ID, 0. Luckily, this is capped by 1000 results, but just by the time it took to respond, which was 11 seconds, you can assume the system is extremely vulnerable to denial of service attacks, as well by simply loading it with requests. Wanna push it further? Let's lose the auth token and send the request again. Any bets on the result? Yeah, it works. So if I, or anyone for that matter, simply run the request against that endpoint in their browser, every single user of this chain of thousands of customers is wide open. You don't even have to be a real user. Not impressed still? Well, we're stepping into the dark side here, so hold on. There's a guest pass you can buy from the club. The profile on my phone seemed to have none. Let's play with that, shall we? We'll start by intercepting the responses, and there is an empty response from Available Passes API. What if it wasn't empty? So I happen to know what a response looks like since I did get a pass last month for my friend and I kept the JSON. If I just paste it as is, without even bothering to change an ID, and forward it to my phone, guess what? I now have a pass to use. I can even tell it the expiry date. Now, this created a pass from thin air without even writing anything into the server's database. Simply by returning it to my phone, the client side of the app just rolls with it. Without checking any forgery or authenticity, I can move forward and book my pass. Heck, I can even play with a price returned from the server, based on which the client side on the phone will then decide how much to charge. You may think this is a lucky find, but it really isn't. This exists everywhere. I actually made a blog post about finding the exact same bug on my home country's mandatory testing centers during COVID. It was literally part of border control, and yes, I reported that too. And by the way, no one bothered to fix it. Still think these things aren't a big deal, or for some reason you consider AI code safe and magically solves security issues? I've got some bad news for you. If you haven't heard, Next.js had a security hole so big you could walk through. And people did. The exploit lets attackers skip middleware authorization checks just by sending a header called X middleware sub-request. Let me repeat that. With a simple header, you can skip any middleware, get unintended information, remember the number one OWASP vulnerability? You can avoid paying for services, and more. Vercel, the Next.js maintainers, and yeah, the most used vibe coding deployment platform, released a patch and a stick measuring contest with Cloudflare. But it gets worse. The bug was reported in February, but the fix didn't drop until March 21st. The community was not happy. If you're self-hosting Next.js, update now. If you're on Vercel or Netlify, you're fine, at least from a current vulnerability standpoint, but this doesn't mean things weren't exposed during that time, so make sure you clean things up. So, we covered potential exploits, now let's learn to defend. Dem Vulnerable Web App is an old yet maintained piece of PHP software that's purposefully crawling with security bugs you can play with, exploit and patch. I recommend playing with it at least a little. Once you're ready, it's time to move over to scanners. The first, most straightforward, and probably the one I use most is GitLeaks, a leak scanner that searches through Git trees to find keys and sensitive information. You can run it as a standalone, through CI, as a container, or in a bunch of other ways. This thing scans, finds, and reports leaks potentially serving as a circuit break between you and the production world. Similarly, Trivy, an open source by Aqua, scans for vulnerabilities in your cloud, Kubernetes clusters, and even binaries. To help summarize the requirements for a properly constructed application, I recommend using the 12-factor app manifesto, a set of principles to live by. The most important rule, in my opinion, is config. Here, you'll find guidelines to what best practice configuration around modern application looks like. To give you the gist of it, applications should be agnostic to their environment. Whether an app runs in staging or production, use one database endpoint or another, it should come from the external config. If built correctly, the same process can run everywhere. So we covered hacking, we talked about protecting. Before moving on to the last critical piece, I want to share a few platforms to help you sharpen your axe, if you will. The first is Wargames, an online and very old site, I must say, of hacking games. You pick one, like I picked the first Bandit, follow the instructions to SSH, in this instance with a different port. Remember, security through obscurity is not a good idea. Give it the password and we're in. This goes with dozens of levels, each with increasing difficulty, and it's great fun while improving your Linux security skills. Once I felt I want more of these, but more complicated, I went on to Hack the Box, a platform which you can use freely, consisting of tons of machines to hack on. Windows, Linux, web apps, databases, and whatnot. When I wanted to actually make some money off of what I've learned, I went over and created an account at HackerOne and then Bugcrowd, legally hacking on platforms like Tesla, Uber, and Yahoo. While I wasn't an extremely successful hacker, I did get a few findings and it taught me so much. Okay, back to the real world. We have one more point to cover, and that is debugging. To help prove my last point, I'll abuse Lovable one last time and have it create a bug in our secure profile app. Once ready and the code is cloned, we can test the app to see that the bug is indeed there. Now I can do it in multiple ways. I can add console logs to print different locations on the app. I can naturally read the code. Here's what real pros do. When they see a critical, complicated bug that's hard to reproduce, they run a debugger. They set breakpoints, they follow the process, and squash that bug like it was nothing. I won't go into all the debugger details, as there's a dedicated video I made and you can find it right up here. But like I said earlier, AI is doing great work by cleaning up for the most part. But in others, it can create some big problems. When bugs pop, and boy they will, not because AI is bad, but because this is the nature of applications, someone will need to pluck them out. Bugs can be business logic based or have a security character, but they will need to be located and removed. Trying to load more AI on problems created by AI can and will cause a lot of frustration. Learn to hack, learn to secure, learn to debug. In a way, I kind of unintentionally described the famous buzz title DevSecOps. Those who will master the aspects around code and know how to maintain it are going to be the next most wanted engineers on the planet. Good, so you're 100% locked, loaded, and ready to storm through AI, at least conceptually. How about taking these things to a practical level and start using NeoVim's debugger to crush any bug, whether created by AI or not? Watch this video next, it covers the setup, operation, basics, and even a bonus for multi-threading process overview through a debugger within NeoVim. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.